The Melba Story. The story of Australia's most famous woman. The true story, fully authenticated, and featuring another wonderful Australian singer, Glenda Raymond. The Melba Story. The first chapter of the Melba Story told of the young Australian singer's determination to make a name for herself as an artist, and of her subsequent meeting with the young Irishman, Charles Armstrong, who was able to persuade her to forget her dreams of fame and settle down as his wife on a sugar plantation at Port Mackay in Queensland. We resume our story a year later, in the year 1883.
There, there. Poor little darling.
He feels the heat, Mrs. Armstrong. The sound of that rain on the iron roof's probably upsetting him, too.
I know. It's bad for him up here. The doctor advised me to take him to a cooler climate. But Charles has his job here, so what can we do?
Isn't that good a job, is it?
No, indeed, Mrs. Rawson. We're finding it pretty hard to make ends meet. The cost of living is terribly high in this part of Queensland.
Do you mind if I ask you a personal question, Mrs. Armstrong?
No, of course not. What is it?
Oh, Mr. Armstrong's father's a baronet, isn't he?
Yes, he's Sir Andrew Armstrong of King's County, Ireland.
Well, couldn't he help? Financially, I mean.
Oh, Charles would never admit he was in need of money. He's too proud.
Well, how about your own father? He's quite well off, isn't he?
Charles wouldn't let me ask him either. Besides, I wouldn't like the idea very much myself. Particularly as I'm sure I could solve the problem without help from anyone.
How?
I believe I could earn quite a lot of money as a singer.
Oh, yes, Mrs. Armstrong, you've got a lovely voice. She never seemed to sing these days.
And you wonder.
Well, when you've had your piano sent all the way up here.
My piano? Oh, listen to it.
I was told you couldn't keep a piano in tune up here. I didn't realize how true it was till now.
Not only that, but it's all covered in mildew, Mrs. Rawson. Everything is. And if you go outside the door, there's mud everywhere, and you're almost eaten alive by insects.
You know, this is the first time I've heard you say a word of complaint.
I could make the best of things if Charles and little George were all right.
Oh, here's Mr. Armstrong now.
It's getting worse instead of better.
Charles, are you all right?
Yes, dear. Just a little knocked out by the weather. Good evening, Mrs. Rawson.
Oh, you don't look too good, Mr. Armstrong.
No, Charles. You're as white as a ghost.
I'm quite all right, thank you. How's young Georgie?
The humidity's been worrying him. It's so hot.
Yes, I suppose so. Well, I'm afraid he'll just have to put up with it, like the rest of us.
This climate's not too good for children, Mr. Armstrong.
Other people's kiddies seem to manage.
Oh, well, you see, they're locals. They're much hardier.
Mrs. Rawson, do you mean that my child is a weakling?
Oh, no, Mr. Armstrong, I didn't mean that.
Mrs. Rawson was only trying to be helpful, Charles.
Yes, I know. I beg your pardon, Mrs. Rawson. I'm a bit on edge tonight.
No offence taken, Mr. Armstrong. I know just how you feel. Oh, well, I suppose I'd better be getting back home. Mr. Rawson will be coming in for tea pretty soon.
Thanks for coming over, Mrs. Rawson. I was glad of your company.
Oh, that's all right, dear. Let me know any time if I can do anything for you.
That's very kind of you, but we'll manage. Thanks very much.
So long, then.
Goodbye, Mrs. Rawson.
I'll see you to the door.
Oh, no, don't bother.
No bother at all.
Oh, do you think you'd better go out in that, Mrs. Rawson?
Oh, bless you, dear. I'm used to it. Hello.
Goodbye. That woman talks too much.
She means well, Charles.
Perhaps so. There are times when I find that kind of thing pretty hard to take.
You had a bad day, dear?
Oh, everything that could possibly go wrong did. I don't know whether I'm surrounded by a collection of blockheads or whether I'm the biggest blockhead of all.
You're not that, Charles.
If it weren't for you and young Georgie, I might have given it away long ago.
But I want to get away as much as you do, Charles. And the doctor says the climate's bad for George. I'm sure you'll be able to find something better.
Where?
Well, in Melbourne, for instance. We could stay at my father's house.
No, I couldn't do that.
Well, I was thinking, dear. Perhaps I could help.
You? How?
Well, you know I've been asked to sing at that concert in Brisbane next week.
You're not being paid for that, are you?
Oh, no, it's a charity affair. But Mrs. Pemberton, she's the organizer, she seems to think I'm good enough to earn money with my voice.
I don't care for that idea very much.
But, Charles...
Anyway, you said you'd give up your singing when we married.
She said something about a series of concerts in Sydney.
It's quite out of the question, Nellie. You know that.
Why is it?
Because, for one thing, you won't be in Sydney.
Well, I wouldn't mind going up there from Melbourne if it were worth my while.
You won't be in Melbourne, my dear. We'll be here, in Mackay.
Charles, don't let's say any more about it tonight. Let's wait until after the Brisbane concert.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, I shall sing for you Tosti's Goodbye.
Thank you. Armstrong, you were wonderful. How many encores were there, Mr. Armstrong?
I don't know. Five, wasn't it?
They could listen to you all night. That voice. It's magnificent. You must sing for me again, my dear.
I'd like to, Mrs. Pemberton, but I'm afraid it won't be possible.
But why?
Because we're going back to Port Mackay first thing in the morning. Nellie, are you ready?
Oh, yes, Charles, I suppose so.
Come along, then.
Aren't you going to tell her how beautifully she sang, Mr. Armstrong?
Oh, of course. It was very good, Nellie. But we'd better get back to the hotel and get some sleep. Don't forget we have to leave for Port Mackay at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Are you really going to take her back to that awful place?
It's her home, Mrs. Pemberton. Come on, Nellie.
All right, Charles. Good night, Mrs. Pemberton.
You won't reconsider my suggestion, Mrs. Armstrong?
I'm afraid it wouldn't be possible. Good night.
Oh, good night, my dear. And let me know if you change your mind.
Change your mind about what, Nellie?
Nothing, Charles. Nothing at all.
I suppose she wanted you to do another concert.
A series of concerts. In Sydney.
Sydney?
I'd be paid this time, Charles.
I wouldn't hear of it, Nellie. I just wouldn't hear of it.
In just a moment, we'll resume the Melba story. The Melba story.
I'm sorry, my dear, but you'll just have to forget this idea of singing in Sydney.
It could help financially, you know, Charles.
I hope the time will never come when I'll have to be supported by my wife. It's a man's place to provide for his family.
I don't know any rule that says a wife shouldn't be allowed to help.
Don't let's say any more about it, Nellie. Now, come along. I have a carriage waiting to take us back to the hotel.
Charles, Mrs. Pemberton said that the man who's arranging those Sydney concerts is in the hall tonight and wants to meet me.
Look, Nellie, I agreed to accompany you to Brisbane so that you could sing at this concert. Well, I've kept my part of the bargain. Now it's up to you to keep yours.
Just what is my part of the bargain, Charles?
To come back to Port Mackay and settle down as a wife and mother.
With both my husband and my son paying the penalty of living in such a place?
Oh, rubbish. Soon as I get used to things, I'll be all right.
You're losing weight. You're looking all white and drawn. And poor little Georgie's not a bit well either. The doctor says he needs a cooler climate.
Where do you suggest we go?
Charles, I've been meaning to say this to you for some time, and tonight gives me the chance. I want to go back to Melbourne.
Melbourne?
Yes. It's where I was born, where my father lives, and I'd like him to see the baby anyway. Besides, there are far more opportunities down there.
You're still thinking of your singing.
It's about time we faced the position squarely, Charles. We failed up here.
You mean I've failed?
No, the fault's mine as much as yours.
How's that?
I should have tried to help you.
Help me? How?
With my voice. You think that's just a joke?
Yep. Oh, please forgive me, Nellie. I shouldn't have laughed.
Well, anyway, will you come to Melbourne?
For a visit, perhaps.
That'll do, Charles. But somehow I feel that we'll never, never see Port Mackay again. And I, for one, won't be sorry.
But, Nellie, what are your plans? I'm very glad to have you back again, of course, but you and Charles can't just drift along doing nothing.
I'm going to take up singing again, Father.
I was talking about important matters. I thought when you got married there'd be an end to all that sort of nonsense.
So did I. But I've come to realize that I was wrong.
Wrong? To want to be a good wife? Wrong to want to look after your baby?
I can do both those things and make a success of singing as well.
Well, there's no harm in humming a bit of a tune about the house, I suppose.
I propose to do my singing on a public platform, Father.
You'll not use my name to do that.
No, of course not. I'll sing as Mrs. Armstrong.
You have it all planned, I see.
Yes, Father, I have. And the first thing is to ask my old teacher, Signor Cecchi, if he'll let me start my lessons again.
Who's going to pay for them?
He'll teach me for nothing.
Oh, rubbish.
It isn't rubbish, Father. He told me that long ago.
Because he knew your father had a few bobbies.
Nothing of the kind. Signor Cecchi isn't interested in money. And I'm going to ask him to prepare me for my next appearance.
What's all this I hear about a concert in Sydney, Nellie?
I don't know what you heard, Father.
I've heard enough to make me very angry. You know how I feel about my daughter singing in public.
I thought you were only concerned about the family name. And that won't be mentioned. I'm being billed as Mrs. Armstrong.
What difference does that make when everyone knows you're my daughter?
You might be proud of me yet, Father.
I'm proud of you now, but not as a singer.
Suppose I made money with my voice. Would that make you change your mind?
How much are you getting for this Sydney concert?
Well...
Come on, how much?
Not very much. But at least it's a start. But it's a benefit concert.
Well, you won't be getting the benefit, that's certain.
Perhaps one day I will. But some of the best artists in Sydney are on the program. And all the critics are going to be there.
The critics, eh? And suppose these critics said you had no future as a singer. Would you accept their verdict?
They couldn't possibly say such a thing. Why, Signor Cecchi told me...
Nellie, if they say you can't sing, will you give up this crazy idea of yours?
Well, I suppose I'd have to.
Very well, then. We'll wait and see what they have to say. And as it happens, I've a little business to do in Sydney. I'll come over with you, Nellie, just to give you a bit of moral support.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we have on our program tonight no less than 5 young artists who are making their first appearance before a Sydney concert audience. Among these is Mrs. Armstrong of Melbourne, who will sing the aria Una Voce Poco Pa from Rossini's Barber of Seville.
Thank you. prima guida.
Want me to sing, Nellie?
How did I sing?
I don't know. I didn't hear you.
But aren't you interested in what I do?
I'm interested in everything but your singing. You know how I feel about it.
I sang well, Father. I know I did.
All right, lass. I won't contradict you. I'll wait until I read what the critics say about you in tomorrow's papers.
Yes, Father. What time is it?
About 6 o'clock. I can never sleep a wink in these Sydney hotels.
I didn't sleep either.
Thinking about last night, I suppose.
Yes. Do you think the papers would have arrived by now, Father?
They've arrived. I've read them.
Were there any reports of the concert?
There were.
Oh, show me, show me.
No, lass, it's better that you shouldn't read them.
Not read them?
You'd only be upset.
I mean... they're bad.
Bad? Why, one of them says your voice is metallic.
No.
It's here in black and white. And you agreed to accept the critic's verdict, didn't you?
Yes, but it isn't conclusive.
Not conclusive? Why, Nellie, if I were in your place, I'd never want to sing again as long as I live.
Melba faces the first great disappointment of her life. The failure of her own people to realize that a world singer had arrived. We'll hear the young singer's reaction to her father's discouraging words in the next chapter of The Melba Story. The Melba Story was written by John Ormiston Reed and produced by Dorothy Crawford. The Australian Symphony Orchestra was conducted by Hector Crawford. The role of Melba was spoken by Patricia Kennedy and sung by the Australian coloratura soprano, Glenda Raymond.